What a wonderful way to start a service. Welcome, everyone. I'm delighted to see you here on this very last day of 2023. So I'll be the first to wish you Happy New Year, and we're moving together into 2024. First of all, I want to greet our musicians this morning, Ray Hunsicker on the organ, and Kendra Werner on the piano, and she will be singing for us later. So you're in for a treat today, for sure. A couple of announcements this week. Obviously, the office is closed on Monday on New Year's Day, but we have bell choir and chancel choir on Wednesday evening, 6 o'clock and 7 o'clock, respectively. And we have men's breakfast at 8 a.m. on Thursday. We've been having great breakfasts. The food is good, but the conversation is better. So I recommend it if you're an early riser and would like to meet us. We have some wonderful discussions at that group. Today is the last day of the month, and we always celebrate the birthdays of that whole month. Of course, that list disappeared from my office. So if you had a December birthday, would you please stand? Okay, Carolyn. Well, let's sing happy birthday to Carolyn. Okay, I'm sorry, can you play happy birthday? Yeah. It would be nice if I told him this one ahead of time. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Carolyn. Happy birthday to you. Just sorry. There's a birthday cake at happy hour today, happy hour, fellowship hour, coffee hour, whatever it's called. It's a happy hour. It really is. So please come and join us. We don't have alcoholic beverages to make it a real happy hour, but we hope that you'll come and greet one another with a happy new year. And now let us begin our worship by the introit.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship found in your bulletin. Come, people of God, let us celebrate, for a child has been born for us.
We gather to share the good news and tidings of great joy. Jesus has come to us.
He is Christ the Lord. God is with us. Now we again sing the joyous carols of Christmas and witness to our Savior's birth. Let us worship God. Please open your hymnals to page 249. There's a song in the air, and let's sing verses 1, 2, and 4.
Mother's deep prayer and the baby's love.
may be seated. Please join me in the prayer in your bulletin. Loving God, we welcome you and invite you to be present in our worship. It's true that the world was not ready to welcome your son into our world on that night in Bethlehem so long ago. But today, on this side of Bethlehem, the cross, and the empty tomb, we are more than ready to listen to your voice, to be obedient to your son, and to be empowered by your spirit. Thank you for your presence with us today, because you are Emmanuel, God with us. Amen.
And now I don't see my little buddies this morning, and so we will go right to the baptism. And I'd like to invite the family to come up. How about the godparents? Yeah. Before I even begin, I want to introduce Nick and Maria to you, and know that they don't live around here. They live in Kodiak, Alaska, because Nick here is serving our country in the Coast Guard. And so we thank them for being here today. Maria's been on a little vacation here with family, and so it's been a wonderful time to do this sacrament of baptism for them. So let us begin. Friends, hear the words of our Lord Jesus. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you, even to the end of the age. Obeying the words of our Lord Jesus and confident of his promises, we baptize those whom God has called. In baptism, God claims us and seals us to show that we belong to God. God frees us from sin and death, unites us with Jesus Christ by his death and resurrection. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are made members of the church, the body of Christ, and joined to Christ's ministry of love, peace, and justice. Let us remember with joy our own baptism as we celebrate this sacrament. So I have some questions for the parents first. Do you reaffirm your own faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? Do you?
Yes.
And do you, relying on God's grace, do you promise to live the Christian faith and to teach that faith to your son?
Yes.
And to the sponsors, do you promise by praying with him and by your support and encouragement help him to be a faithful Christian? And to the congregation, if we are given the opportunity to have him in Sunday school someday when you're not in Kodiak, Alaska anymore, my question to you, do you as members of the Church of Jesus Christ promise to guide and nurture Leo by word and deed with love and prayer, encouraging him to know and follow Christ and to be a faithful member of Christ's church? Thank you. Let us pray. Eternal and gracious God, we give you thanks. In countless ways you have revealed yourself in ages past and have blessed us with signs of your grace through water and the Spirit. In the beginning, your Spirit hovered over the dark deep. From this formless void, you brought forth light and life. By the waters of the flood, you cleaned the world and made with Noah and his family a new beginning for all people. In the time of Moses, you led your people out of slavery through the waters of the sea, making a covenant with them in a new land. At the appointed time, in the waters of the Jordan, when Jesus was baptized by John, you sent your Spirit upon him. And now, by the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, Christ sets us free from sin and death and opens the way to eternal life. Pour out your Spirit upon us and upon this water, that it may be a fountain of deliverance and rebirth for Leo. May all who pass through these waters be delivered from death to life, from bondage to freedom, from sin and righteousness and new life in you. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Got my microphone. Here we go, bud. Okay. By what name shall this child be called?
Leo Cash.
Okay. Leo Cash, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. O Lord, uphold Leo with your Spirit. May you give him the counsel, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Leo Cash, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked as Christ's own forever. Amen. I'm going to introduce him to the congregation. This is the newest member of the Church of Jesus Christ, not just the Margate Community Church, but the Church Universal. He is part of the family of Christians that believe in the Lord Jesus and trust in him. This is your little family, Leo, believe it or not. You're a little too small to remember this, but we're going to remember you. And he has a new last name. He has the name Christian that all of us have as baptized members of the Church of Jesus Christ. And now I'm going to give him back to mommy or daddy. Okay. What a sweetheart. That's the best part of my job. Let us pray. Merciful God, you call each of us by name and promise us your constant love. We have now baptized Leo in your name and sealed his identity in you. Watch over this little one, and as the years go by, deepen his understanding of your love. Gracious God, we pray for his parents and parents everywhere. Give them wisdom and patience to guide their child in the way of Jesus Christ. Let your peace and joy dwell in their home, that their family life may be instructed by faith, sustained by prayer, and governed by love. This morning, Lord God, we rejoice with you that Leo will always know who he is, that as he faces the mysteries of life and death, he will remember always that he is yours. And for this very day, he was baptized. We pray your blessing on the whole family and on the life that awaits Leo. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Okay, and welcome to the church. And I have some little gifts here for you, okay? We have a baptism certificate there and a rose to commemorate the day. He's hungry for pizza. Okay, you can go sit down. And let us sing the baptism hymn number 420, verses 1 and 2.
Please join me in the affirmation of faith. We believe in the living God, the God of all people, who creates life and sustains the universe by his power and love. We believe in Jesus, the Christ, the baby born in Bethlehem, the man of Nazareth, revealer of God, and model of all humanity, the greatest gift of love, our Savior and the guide for all our living. We believe in the Spirit of God, a spirit that inspires us to creative living and empowers us to be persons of hospitality, compassion, joyfulness, and love.
Thanks, Nancy. As we come to our time of prayer, I'd like to remind you of some of the concerns of our church family. We're continuing prayers for Dave McCann, Ken Heck, Patricia Zappone, Cynthia Mario, Neil Gamble, Lexi and her family, that's Bobby Mario's granddaughter, praying for Fran, for Tim, Dorothy, and Dawn, Carolyn, Athena, Don Green, Joanne DeJohn's friend Joanne, who is battling cancer, Carol Zerbe's brother Bob, Maria, Catherine Sheeran, Dylan, Gerald, Dana, Holly and Beth, Carl Ekstrom, who is recovering at home, Judy Haverstick, and Linda Donovan's mom, Gladys, in XL Rehab. Are there any other joys or concerns to share? Yes. At Shore Memorial, Martha? Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you for the news, Martha. We will definitely be in prayer for Carl Ekstrom. Chrissy?
Matt.
Praying for Matt. Then let's join our hearts and minds in prayer. Let us pray. Merciful God, you have been our help in ages past and our hope for years to come. As this new year, 2024, begins in just a few hours, we are here in your house or our homes online with praise and thanksgiving because you have come to us with love in the person of Jesus. Though many things have changed during the past year, there are some things that do not. Our love and praise and thanks for your being with us and strengthening us for the changes we have faced and will continue to face. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage, that we may meet the challenges of this dawning new year in the spirit of Christ who came to us as our Savior. We pray for the Church Universal where all your children are invited to be part of your family. We ask your blessing on little Leo and his family, and we thank you for the gift of baptism for each of us, where we are marked and sealed as Christ's own forever. We continue our prayers for healing in our world. We give thanks for new therapies for diseases like COVID and cancer that are being used. We ask again for peace, most especially that the wars will end in Ukraine and Israel, that the hostages will come home safely, and that innocent people will be secure. We continue to pray for the leaders of the world that greed and lust and power may be curbed, and all people enter the community of love promised in Jesus Christ. You have heard the concerns of this church family. Hear now those worries that lie deeply in our hearts. Grant us your peace. As we begin this new year, Lord, walk with us. Give us a new vision this morning. Let us hear again your words, "Fear not, I am with you always." Let us focus on all that you have given to us and assure us that you will continue to lead us and guide us to fulfill your plans for us. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus and pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now let us continue our worship by presenting our tithes, our gifts, and our offerings. Let us pray. We thank you, O God, that you have blessed us with gifts beyond measure. We thank you especially for the gift of your Son, Jesus, who you sent to be our Savior. We bring these gifts to you today with grateful hearts. Use these gifts and use us for telling the glad news of your love to all the earth. We pray in the name of the baby of Bethlehem, Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Please be seated. Well, first, a little explanation here is in order. I'm not going to read the scripture passage that's in the bulletin. This bulletin was printed about a week and a half ago, almost 2 weeks ago, and ideas and things change over the time. So I am going to read just a small portion of Matthew's gospel when Jesus is speaking to the Roman centurion. Now, what's always interesting about these gospel writings is that the disciples were having trouble figuring out who Jesus was. They were with him every day. They were listening to him and watching him. But somehow or other, it took them a little bit longer to figure out that Jesus was the Messiah, the Christ. But it seems that the foreigners, the Gentiles even, figured it out almost immediately. And so this is a little story about Jesus and the Roman centurion. This is Matthew chapter 8, verses 5 through 10. So listen for God's word to you this morning. When Jesus entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, appealing to him and saying, "Lord, my servant is lying home paralyzed in terrible distress." And Jesus said to him, "I will come and cure him." The centurion answered, "Lord, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only speak the word, and my servant will be healed. For I am also a man under authority with soldiers under me. And I say to them, go, and they go, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my slave, do this, and the slave does it." When Jesus heard him, he was amazed and said to those who followed him, "Truly I tell you, no one in Israel have I found with such faith." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Does anyone here know what it means to sail under sealed orders? If you're in the Navy, I don't think the Coast Guard would do that, but if you're in the Navy, and probably not since World War II have they done anything like that that was super secret, but I don't think it's used very often these days. Anyway, it works like this. A ship is in the dock, the crew is ready to get underway, but they're still waiting for their orders. Someone official brings an envelope to the captain on the bridge, and that envelope is sealed. The captain knows that inside that envelope are the crew's orders, the details of the ship's mission and their destination. Stamped on the front of the envelope are the words, "Sailing under sealed orders." And printed also on the outside of the envelope is some coordinates, longitude and latitude, a place in the middle of the ocean where they are to sail. Now, for the sake of military secrecy, the captain has been trained not to open that envelope until he gets to the spot that the latitude and longitude has told him. So the ship and the crew set sail, not knowing exactly where they're going, but trusting headquarters. When the ship reaches those coordinates of latitude and longitude, the captain opens the envelope and discovers what their final destination is going to be and what their mission is. Well, in a sense, I think the Christian faith is a lot like that. We don't receive all the information for our lives all at once. I think we all know that. We move along, placing our confidence in headquarters. We move forward, trusting God. We sail under sealed orders until we get to the place where God says, "Okay, you've made it this far. Now here's the next move," or something to that effect. One of the
most highly respected missionary some years ago was a devout and committed Christian woman named Virginia Law Shell. Not only was she a missionary herself, she was the child of missionary parents who served in the Congo. She wrote about a lesson she learned about trusting God one dark night in a little story from her childhood. She wrote this: "Our missionary compound employed older men from the village to stand as night watchmen. One night, I heard a familiar cough on my front porch. When I went to the door, I could just make out the figure of a native guard named Papa Jean, who was one of the most trusted of all the guards. No moon or stars were shining that night. There were no street lights in that isolated mission. It was very, very dark. A small 6-inch smoky kerosene lantern was in Papa Jean's hand that gave the tiniest amount of light. She said, I thought to myself, such a pitiful little light on such a dark night. She said to the guard, that lamp doesn't give you much light, does it, Papa Jean? No, he answered, it doesn't, but it shines as far as I can step. Virginia said she often remembered Papa Jean and how she learned to trust God in the same way. God's light always shines just enough for our next step. We take a step forward in life and then have to have the confidence that God will give us more light as we move along. And I think that's really one of the basic tenets of the Christian life. In the scripture lesson I just read, the centurion who asked Jesus to come to his house to heal his servant had that kind of confident faith. When Jesus agrees to go and heal the servant, the centurion replies, Lord, I'm not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only say the word, and my servant will be healed. And a couple of verses later, as we heard, Jesus marvels at the faith of that man. Jesus remarks that faith to the people who were following him. He says, truly, I tell you, no one in Israel has as much faith as this centurion. Now, we have to remember that the centurion was not a Jew. He had probably been raised in Rome on gods and goddesses, or maybe he had no religion whatsoever. He was a mercenary soldier. We have to remember all of these things, or he's just saying here, though, Lord, if you just say the word, my servant will be healed. What confidence, what faith, what trust. The centurion knew without a doubt that Jesus would not let him down. He took that first step by asking Jesus for help, and then he had confidence that Jesus would take the next one with him. We're on the brink of a new year today, so how does this story speak to us? Well, if you believe in God, then make it your number one priority to live as a child of God. Accept God as the center of your life. And when you do, I believe everything else will fall in place. In other words, do your best in the present and put your confidence in God for the future. Well, let me bring it a little closer to home by lifting up three of the resources we have so that we Christians can have confidence. Number one, the Bible is the place to begin. John Wesley often referred to himself as a man of the book. He said that many years ago, but it's still advice, the Bible is not some outdated book that was written by primitive, superstitious people. We all need help to get through life, and it's the wise person who turns to the Bible for direction, for help, for comfort, and for strength. Think about it this way. If somehow we were to bring together the brightest minds of our generation, psychologists, professors, theologians, lawyers, judges, scientists, doctors, and historians, bring them together and ask them to write the handbook for life, for living a sane, meaningful, and productive life, a handbook that would be both profound and practical, and it would give straightforward instructions for joyful living. I think if we put all their thoughts together, refined them, and edited them down to a series of basic principles for living, we would discover that that handbook was already written 2,000 years ago, the Bible. And the efforts of all these brilliant people would pale in comparison to what we already have in the scriptures. The point is this: it is the book. We've had it all along. For nearly 2,000 years, we have held in our hand the key to life, the instruction manual, the answer to our questions and yearnings, the guidebook par excellence, the Word of God. Now, please don't misunderstand me. I am not suggesting that we can master the Bible in 5 minutes or in a couple of Bible studies you might come to here at church. I'm not suggesting that finding life's answers in the Bible is as easy as thumbing through the answer pages at the back of a math book. And don't use it as a Ouija board either, opening a spot, running your finger down, and finding out what God wants to tell you today. That doesn't work. Trust me on that. If we want to discover the great truths of Scripture, then we need to spend time with it. A minister I knew told me about a time when he was a senior in college in Michigan. His girlfriend, now this is all before computers, probably in the 80s or 90s, his girlfriend, who would become his wife, wrote him a letter every single day. Ah, love. This was before they had the instant messaging things. And she would write that letter, and he would write back every day. My friend would go to the campus office and go right to his mailbox, number 716, take out the letter from his girlfriend, tear it open, and read every word. Then on his way back to his dorm, he'd be reading again as he walked. I hope he didn't fall. And when he got to his room, he would close the door and read it again carefully and slowly, savoring every word. He read it again before he went to bed at night. And when he got up in the morning, he read it again and then started writing his letter to her, and waiting for that day to start all over again when he would run to his mailbox and get her next letter. That's how it is when you're in love. And that's exactly how to read the Bible, like a letter from someone who genuinely and truly loves you. In fact, someone once called the Bible God's love letter to human beings. The late great tennis player Arthur Ashe wrote an autobiography before he died early in 1993. The closing chapter of the book is a letter, a personal letter, to his daughter, Chimera. He shared many of his hopes and dreams for her, but he included this little piece at the end. He wrote, "Chimera, have faith in God. Don't be tempted either by pleasures or material possessions or by claims of science and smart thinkers into believing that religion is obsolete, that the worship of God is somehow beneath you. Spiritual nourishment is as important as physical nourishment and intellectual nourishment. Don't beg God for favors either. Instead, ask God for the wisdom to know what is right, what God wants done, and the will to do it. Know the Bible. You will find inscribed there the meaning of life and the way you should live." Arthur was saying, You can have confidence in the Bible. And secondly, have confidence in the church. Lean on your church family. That's why we're together. We're here in this place to build one another up and to help each other. We're not here just to sit in the pews. We're a family in Christ. Sadly, in recent years, the world has, for the most part, turned away from the church. I don't need to tell you that. They've even mocked the church. And now they're basically just ignoring the church. I think that's coming back to haunt us in our nation and in the world. Polls say that people are more pessimistic than ever today. Besides the pandemic that's still with us, I had it again 2 weeks ago, and the economy and the wars going on, Americans are worried and scared about crime, drugs, violence, and lack of family values. But I think there's some good news here for the church in general. We are here in this church, and we can view it as an opportunity. If most people are finally realizing that secularism can't save us, that we certainly can't save ourselves, that we cannot find meaning or fulfillment or security or happiness in things, then we need to look beyond ourselves at the larger picture. And this is where we can be ambassadors for God. Which brings us to the third and last thing on my little list of things in which we can have confidence, and that's God. There's a story about a pastor in Washington who got a call late one night from the bus station. The call was from a young man who had grown up in one of the churches he had served years before. The young man had gotten really off track. He'd been experimenting with drugs, lost touch with his family, was living on the streets, no money, and no food. Could he get some help from his old pastor? Well, of course, the pastor went right to that bus station. He couldn't believe his eyes. The young man was filthy and emaciated in body and broken in spirit. The pastor brought him home and made him some food. And while they sat together, the pastor asked the guy if he had ever asked God to help him. The young man said, "No, but when I get myself together and I start coming back to church, then I'm going to ask God to help me." And the pastor said, "My friend, it will never happen that way. If you think you can get yourself together on your own and then come to God, you'll never do it. You're going to have to come to God just as you are this moment. And then God will give you the strength to get started getting things together." So this morning, I don't know what your problems are. We all have them. But I do know this. You can bring your problems to God and put your confidence in Him. God will help you. And I don't know what your worries are, but I do know this. You can bring your worries to God and put your confidence in Him. God will help you. And I don't know what your sins are, but I do know this. Whatever it is, you can bring it to God and trust Him, and God will help you. Life is tricky and dangerous and sometimes darn right hard. But we have some helps out there in this soup. We are not alone. As we move into this new calendar year, we have God's word to guide us, we have God's people to surround us, and we have God to hold us in His strong, powerful hands. If you have confidence in God, you can sail into the new year under sealed orders. Trust God for the future. Will you pray with me? Lord, be with us as we start a new year. We don't know what the future will bring, but we know You hold the future. Let us be smart and ask for Your guidance and protection. knowing that you hold all of us in your strong, powerful hands. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's sing our last hymn, a very joyful hymn, Go Tell It on the Mountain, number 251.
Please join us for coffee hour. We'd love to see you there. And when you leave here, have confidence that God is with you. God doesn't stop at midnight tonight. God goes with you into that new year to guide you and to protect you and to be with you and with those whom you love. Amen.